Con Scotty Kilmer, un mecánico que responde a cualquier tipo de preguntas.
So here we are at the Circuit of the Americas with Scotty Kilmer, and we are enjoying the whole weekend with Shell, and enjoying all the Ferrari Challenge races, the Porsche Super Cup races, and just a great thing. Thank you for being with us here, Scotty.
Yeah, no problem. I'm having a great time here. You know?
So we come here at the races, and we watch races most of the time on TV over the weekends, and then some people who are luckier than us get up to drive.
Yeah, we flew here.
Exactly. No, I mean, drive on the track and on the actual races. So, I mean, races, obviously, it's a big part of the auto industry, and there's a lot of relationship with what we drive daily, right? So you, as an expert mechanic and giving advice, what can people learn from racing and for the daily driver?
Well, you know, that's how they get the new modern technology out, and they test everything out. They can test out the fuels, and if you take a few years ago, it was relatively uncommon that people would have extremely fast revving turbocharged engines, but they're all going to that.
Yeah.
And now with this race, they're using hybrid cars. So they're using hybrid technology, just like in the Toyota Priuses and the Fords and the GMs that they're putting out there. And it's basically the same technology. And since they're stressing everything here to an nth degree, they can actually find out what's wrong with these systems before you get it. Because let's face it, they can make something, they can go 200 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And you're very rarely going to go over 80 miles an hour.
If you're lucky, you might get a ticket before that.
they can improve it, and then you get something out of it. It's just like the space program using electronics that we use today. I mean, it's the
but,
same thing.
Yeah, with this new technology and the way it advances today, it's much quicker. I mean, because like I guess like 15, when Formula One started, like always, it's always been a lab for like the production cars. But now this technology transfers to production cars much quicker.
Yeah, well, because everything is going faster and faster, and the governments are mandating a lot of stuff. Like in the United States, they've got gas mileage mandation that they're going to have to get 50-something miles a gallon in
54 the next by 2025. Yeah. That's a lot.
So they need to really push things like this in order to be able to do that.
Yeah. And the other thing, I mean, we were just hearing Marc Genet, the Formula One test driver for Ferrari, talking about how they use 5 engines for the whole season, and each engine only runs 4,000 kilometers, which is like 2,500 miles.
Yeah, but the stress that they're taking is your car never going to take that kind of stress.
Yeah.
You know? So that's not going to... It tests them to the nth degree, and it's, they do a lot of serious engineering when they're done. I had an interview the other day with their fuel guy, and I mean, he's a genius. The stuff that they're studying for this will eventually leak its way down. And the gasoline that you buy at the pump today is radically different than the stuff they were using 20 years ago.
Yeah. And also, Shell, the thing that surprised me a lot was also about the lubricants. I mean, how, like, they have two kinds of lubricants for the practice, which is a little bit thicker, more viscosity, and the race oil is almost like water. That's pretty amazing, too, huh?
Yeah, well, it really is. But, you know, that's where people are always asking me with their modern-day cars. They'll say, okay, I've got a car, and they told me I'm supposed to use zero-weight 30 oil. Mm-hmm. Okay, they can do that when it's new, when it's running. But just like in these races, if that car's got 150,000 miles on it, you're going to have to go to a little thicker oil if you want that engine to last. Otherwise, it's going to burn a lot of oil.
Or it's going to blow the engine.
Well.
So, is that one of the most common mistakes that people do when they, like, because oil is the first step of maintaining a car running well, right?
Yeah, and other parts of the world, I'm sure it's different, but the United States, Americans aren't that big on maintenance.
Yeah.
And so, unfortunately, in the past few years, they've been giving people ideas that, they can change their oil every 15,000 miles. Now, if you're the type of person that gets a new car every 5 or 6 years and you don't put more than 100,000 miles, you can do that. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it.
And the oil technology has also improved a lot.
Yeah, but if you're somebody like me that drives cars that are 20, 30 years old,
yeah,
you can't do that. You change it more frequently so the engines don't wear out.
Yeah. So what's your recommendation for like regular oil and synthetic oil?
Okay, then, you know, that's a tricky question because synthetic oil, there's no real definition of what synthetic oil is. Now, if you go to the high-end synthetic oils like the Shell and the synthetic oil, Redline, Mobil 1, those things, they're great oils. You got to decide whether it's overkill for you or not.
Yeah.
Now, if you live in a very cold climate like Alaska, it's a great idea because it flows at cold temperatures. So when you start the engine, you're not starting it dry. So there, that's a very good idea. But if you live in a normal climate, if you do a lot of driving, you can use it and change it less frequently. But if you do less driving, I don't advise people to buy that kind of oil, because just use a conventional oil, because you're wasting your money. Oil gets deteriorated by water and acid, so you got to change your oil every 6 months anyway.
Yeah.
So if you're
regardless of the mileage.
That's right. So if you're somebody that drives, say, 15,000 miles a year, you're better just buying conventional oil and changing it twice a year than you are buying the synthetic oil.
Yeah, when we came with Shell to Houston for the Indy Grand Prix there, and I was talking to one of the experts, the scientifics actually, Shannon, and she was, her good definition of the synthetic and regular is like regular oil is like gravel, and synthetic is like sand, so more refined. Like that's the way
it can be
explained.
And the thing is, they can do it different ways. They can do it with an acid treatment. They can do it with a steam treatment. Or like in the Hens Oil stuff, they're just making that in Saudi Arabia out of natural gas, which, of course, is going to be the purest of them all, because there's no greeniness of it all. It comes from gas itself.
So going back to the car, the Formula One cars, that now they have smaller engines, more powerful engines, but also using the hybrid powertrains combined. You think that's where the auto industry is going to be? Like in 15, 20 years, every car is going to have some kind of electric hybrid component?
You know, that I really don't know. I'm on a fence on that one, because it costs so much more to make this. And in terms of what you're using the vehicle at is going to be what is the real breaking point. For example, we went to Alaska last year, and in Seattle, they use Priuses for taxi cabs.
Yeah.
Priuses can get 45 miles a gallon in town, yet on the highway,
they're
going to get the same gas mileage or even worse than a conventional engine. So if you're doing a lot of stop-and-go traffic in town, it makes total sense. But if you're, say, a businessman that commutes a lot, you're actually losing your money. I had a customer in Houston that looked at it, and he said, it would take me 30 years to break even in a hybrid.
The investment, yeah.
But you know, in Houston, the meter maids use them.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot less gas they're using.
And also, actually, like, for example, if you compare, like, a diesel engine, like, a small diesel engine, like, in a Golf or something like that against a Prius, they get, like, exactly the same mileage, but both city and highway.
Yeah. And, of course, it's tremendously cheaper to build the diesel engine than it is to build the hybrid system. And it's going to be a matter of, you know, how can they do it? And really, if it got into true mass production, there's only a certain amount of lithium on the planet.
Yeah, exactly.
And can you make that many batteries? It'd be questionable, you know?
And then what do you do with the batteries after that? Like, because that's a big problem, too. I mean, how do you recycle those batteries and then process them to, like, not get become a big problem when they don't have any more use in the car?
That's true. But with that, since lithium is at a big price point, they would recycle the lithium for sure.
Yeah.
They don't do it now because it's not enough mass, but if they got a mass, they'd be recycling the lithium. Just like they recycle, they used to just throw away the catalytic converters, but now they melt them down, they take the platinum back. So.
And then use it for something else. So something that's stuck in my head about the cars. So people, I mean, there's like very good options for cars. There's no bad cars anymore in the market. But people have to be smart to what to choose when they buy, right?
Oh, definitely. I mean, you should try to find somebody like me, a real mechanic that works on it. It'll tell you in your area, here's what is a good car. Because there are better cars and there's worse cars. And you want
to. But new cars in the market, there's no bad car anymore.
There's some bad ones out there. Let me tell you.
What's bad? I mean, like, that's subjective. I mean, but like quality wise and like reliability wise, I mean, they're pretty. I mean, obviously there's better than worse, but like the average is pretty good compared to 20 years ago. Let's say.
Yeah, definitely. The only thing that I've got, just to be the devil's advocate to that, is that in modern cars, unfortunately, planned obsolescence has gone up in all of them with the use of plastics and electronics.
Yeah.
So you can't expect to buy a car and drive it for 20 or 30 years because it won't hold up. The plastic will degrade. The electronics will go bad. So, you know, in that sense,
There's a give and take between technology, yeah, mass production, cheaper cars. Because you get a $15,000 car, let's say like a Nissan Versa. It's a fantastic car. $15,000 is not a lot of money for something like that.
That's true. You know, yeah. And if that's the type of car, you feel comfortable in that type of car. And if you're into a luxury car, you want to do research of, you know, which luxury car is right for you. I mean,
there's something for everybody, yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, and you don't want to be going out and, you know, just say, I'm going to buy a Jaguar because they're notorious for having problems. And they still do, regardless. And in that respect, you really have to know what you're looking for in a luxury car.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Scotty, where can our audience can look for your stuff and, like, enjoy all your advice and topics?
All they have to do is Google Scotty Kilmer, Scotty Kilmer channel on YouTube. I got 59 million views so far. I answer people's questions. You can watch my videos, learn how to fix your own car. I'm out there. You can't get me today because I'm at the races, but I'll be back at it tomorrow, Monday.
Well, thank you very much, Cody, for your time, and we're going to keep enjoying the weekend here with Shell in Austin.
Este programa fue una producción de National Latino Broadcasting.